this week we're talking to Asha Ellen, who's the executive director of the Keep Macon Bibb Beautiful. And I guess full closure is in effect here. I'm a member of that board, so don't expect anything tough from me. Good to have you with us. We've got the year started off with a bang, really, as we usually do with the big Bring One to the Chipper program.
Yes, we always, for the last 33 years, Keep Macon Bibb Beautiful has been hosting the annual Christmas tree recycling event. Bring One to the Chipper is always the first Saturday in January. And so we kicked off the year with Bring One to the Chipper, and it was quite a successful event.
We had about nearly 200 trees in there, and then the ground up. Made mulch out of them.
Yes, yes, yes. And we had over 70 volunteers that came out and assisted us that day, from helping to unload the trees. And, of course, the Boy Scouts are always there helping with the mulch. And we had students from various public and private schools that volunteered, of course, as well as the Keep Macon Bibb Beautiful board members. So it's definitely a generational event, and it's definitely community focused.
You mentioned volunteers. That's extremely important, these volunteers, to keep making it beautiful.
Oh, exactly. We could not do what we do without the support of our dedicated volunteers, from our board members, such as yourself, but also to various community organizations, our schools, our faith-based community, our faith-based partners, all help us with our various community service initiatives.
Basically, you coordinate volunteers. That's a big part of it, isn't it?
It is a huge part, so huge to the point where at first I was managing all of that, but I'm grateful to now actually have a volunteer coordinator, a young lady who was previously an intern for Wesleyan College, and then she came on board to be a part-time volunteer coordinator. So that really has helped to even enhance our volunteer program.
Well, who can volunteer? I mean, what kind of volunteers do you get?
Well, you know, volunteers can come in all shapes, forms, and fashions, from, you know, from a church group to a neighborhood watch association to a youth group to an individual who may just want to do their part in helping us keep making Bibb beautiful. So anyone can volunteer. We had even elementary school classrooms to volunteer, do cleanups like around the school campus. But we've also had high school groups. We've had Scouts, the Boy Scouts, the Girl Scouts, the 4-H organizations, pretty much any organization, any individual who is willing and able to roll up their sleeves and get their hands a little dirty to volunteer with us.
What's the advantage, let's say, of an individual who wants to clean up the neighborhood a little bit, of calling you? I mean, what can you do for them?
Well, absolutely. And we have that happen a lot, where sometimes it's just an individual. And we, of course, don't want our citizens to have to use their own supplies. And so what we do for individuals as well as groups and organizations that host cleanups, we provide at no cost to them trash bags, litter grabbers, disposable gloves, and safety vests. And so those are the items that we provide, the resources, so individuals don't have to use their own supplies when keeping our community clean.
Some of the things like the grabbers, are those like loaners?
Yes and no. Now, we do have some organizations who, on a regular, consistent basis, they adopted a location or spot, and because they do regular cleanups, we're able to let them just hold on to those items. But for those who may just be doing an occasional, you know, once a year cleanup, then we loan those items, and so we do ask that they return them, so that way we can reuse those items.
You can equip large groups, can you?
Yes, we've equipped groups. We recently, just speaking of the beginning of the year, kicking off, we had hosted an MLK community cleanup where we had over 100 volunteers to show up for that event. And we were able to assist them as far as providing the supplies and resources, as well as, of course, I was out there as well with them for that cleanup. So in a case like that, there was a group of over 100 people, but we were still able to accommodate them. So whether it was one or 100, we had the resources and the tools to be able to
What happens on cleanup of that size? What do? When they get together and...
Well, it takes a lot of coordinating as far as with various groups, but a cleanup of that size, it actually consisted of 12 to 15 organizations that came together and united as one that day to host this cleanup. But it wasn't just the volunteers, it wasn't just those organizations. We also had support from our Macon Bibb Parks and Beautification Department, our Macon Bibb Solid Waste Department. All of these organizations came together to play a part because there are a lot of different moving pieces to having a cleanup of that magnitude. So it takes public, private, and community support as a whole to be able to accommodate a group of that size.
You mentioned the parks and beautification folks. They're a big help.
Oh, they're a huge help. We could not do a lot of the projects and initiatives that we do, from cleanups to some of our recycling events. We would not be able to do those great ones with the chipper if we did not have the support from not just parks and beautification, but also solid waste, public works, and even in some cases where we utilize the recreation centers, parks and recreation, so code enforcement as well. So all of these departments, Keep Macon Bibb Beautiful, we work in partnership with to be able to achieve our mission, which is improving the quality of life for all citizens of Macon Bibb through litter reduction, beautification, and education.
What other group that we keep crossing paths with, Neighborhood Watch?
Oh, yes. Well, we are also blessed to have on our board the Neighborhood Bibb County Sheriff's Department Neighborhood Watch Coordinator, Judy Gordon. She is on our board, and so just by having her as a resource, we have an opportunity to be able to go to several of the Neighborhood Watch meetings that happen throughout the county and talk to citizens, not just about cleanups, but the Neighborhood Watch groups have also been very instrumental in the success of our revamp the quarter program. A lot of those nominations that we've received have come through neighbors through the Neighborhood Watch program. I also even must add, even with the MLK cleanup, speaking of the Sheriff's Department, they partnered with us as well. So we have the support of a lot of our private businesses, as well as individual citizens, as well as organizations, but also our various Macon Bibb County agencies and departments.
What's the yard of the month, yard of the quarter, or whatever? Why do that?
Well, we spend a lot of time focusing on as far as the cleanup and the litter, but we also have those individuals in our community who are doing beautiful things as far as keeping their yards, neat and clean and properly manicured. And so we want to also show some recognition to those individuals and highlight also the beautiful things that are going on. So I tell people, keep making it beautiful. Even though the foundation of what we do begins as far as with community cleanups, but we also want to highlight those. Everyone's not littering. Some people have beautiful yards and flowers and trees and gardens, and we want to also recognize them as well. So that's where Yard of the Quarter, which was previously Yard of the Month, but now we're just doing it on a quarterly basis. That's where that beautification initiative came from, to highlight a lot of the beauty that we have here in our city.
If somebody's interested in nominating, they can nominate their own yard.
They can nominate their own yard, exactly. We just had our most recent nomination, so the next one will open up for the spring, and so individuals can be on the lookout for that announcement late March at the Aperture Blossom Festival. So sometime late March, early April, we'll do our spring Yard of the Quarter nominations, where we'll open it. Via social media, we advertise that also via our website, and then a lot of other organizations, the Neighborhood Watch groups, we send a blast out to them, and then also too, I had an opportunity to talk to a couple of garden clubs, and so hopefully we'll also have some of the garden clubs on board as well. But anyone, they can nominate themselves or a neighbor.
This doesn't have to be a yard with thousands of dollars of fancy things either. I mean, a nice mowed yard.
Exactly. And But what I'm so proud of as far as currently all the letters we've had thus far have come from all parts of Macon. We've had homes featured that in East Macon, as well as North Macon, Historic Bottomville, the Bloomfield area, South Macon. And so it does not matter the size of the yard. It does not have to be, you don't have to be a homeowner if you're rich, but you still keep up your yard and maintain your yard. It's open to everyone. If someone lives in an apartment, but they have, you know, in their area with potted plants and things such as that, they can also be nominated. So there is no limit as far as who can be nominated. You don't have to have fancy landscaping or anything such as that. And like I said, thus far we have focused on and on homes that are featured throughout Macon, not just one section of Macon, but the entire city.
You know, if you want to volunteer, or if you want to nominate something or anything else you do, your contact number.
Yes, well, first, you know, you can always reach us 24/7 via our website, which is www.keepmaconbibbbeautiful.org. But they can also give us a call at 478-330-7054. And then they can follow us either on Instagram or Facebook. We're present through those platforms as well.
Well, let's get back to our calendar. So far, we've had the chipper, and we've had the MLK weekend cleanup. You have a big paper shredding thing coming up.
Yes, that will be coming up in late February, February 24th, to be exact. This will be our second one. We did one back in November, but this one will be February 24th from 9 a.m. to 12 p.m. in the rear parking lot at Luther Williams Field, which is located inside of Carroll Green Park. And this will be an opportunity at no cost to the citizens to bring anyone who has any old documents that they've been holding on for decades. They can come to this event. There's no cost. And it's a drive-through event. They don't have to get out of their cars if they choose not to. We'll have plenty of volunteers. Only thing they have to do is pop the trunk and we'll take their bags or boxes of paper and they'll be shredded in a safe manner. We partner once again with Shred Monster for this, and then we do the support of generous donations and grant funding. We're able to host this. So the Community Foundation of Central Georgia, we were awarded a grant from them. So the funds that we receive from that grant is going to allow us to be able to offer this service at no cost to the attendees, as well as we also receive financial support from Synovus Bank.
What type of reaction did you have at the first one?
The first one, we had a great response. We spreaded over 10,000 pounds of paper.
That's a lot of paper.
We had about 200 people to come through during that three-hour time period. And so we're looking to hopefully exceed that and hoping that as we do more and more of these, you know, it will draw more and more people. Once again, it's a service that if you took that same product to an organization or a company where you had to pay a fee, it could be significant dollars, whereas this is an opportunity at no cost for the citizens.
Now, this stuff isn't laying along the street curbs or anything. Why do a paper shredding thing in the first place?
Well, we definitely want to. So we want this to be able to offer a service to our community. We want to protect our landfills and then also because, you know, people could easily just throw the stuff away themselves. But we also found we live in a day and age where I had a friend earlier who received a call from his bank due to some suspicious activity on his account. So we also unfortunately live in a day and age where if our important documents aren't properly shredded, that, you know, it could result in being victims of identity theft as well. So as far as serving two purposes, one, to know
along with all the volunteers that help you. You also accept cash contributions, too.
Yes.
And you got some help with this paper shredding, didn't you?
Yes. Well, with the paper shredding, with the one that we have, that's from like February 24th, that's as well as the grant from the Community Foundation of Central Georgia, as well as a donation from Sonoma State. But the one that we did previously, that was a combination. Sonoma State played a role in that as well. And then also, too, just through our own funds that we had allocated and budgeted for the event. So through donations, whether it's corporate, a lot of our donations do come as far as corporate donations. We've been able to do things like the paper and document shredding previously also, too, sort of going backwards, speaking of corporate donations, through a generous donation of $10,000 in Cox Communications through their Cox Conserves program. We were able to get a $10,000 grant
that's Cox.
Yes.
That's my cable bill.
Yes.
Good to know it's being used.
Your cable bill went to good use.
Okay, we're past the paper shredding. Where do we go next this year?
Oh my gosh. So right now we're really getting ready, of course, for Cedar Blossom Festival. Because our role, of course, is, and it's always been there with us, is with the selling of the cherry blossom trees. So we're actually in the process right now of getting everything finalized. We have to, it's a process even with that, of getting our trees from the tree supplier that we receive from Tennessee. So I'm working on that now so we can be ready when we stop for the 10 days of the Cherry Blossom Festival with our tree singers.
And that takes place down at Carroll and Creighton Park.
At Carroll and Creighton
Park. In the round building?
Yes, in the round building.
And do you have any idea how many trees we're going to bring this year?
Well, we're looking at probably about 500, give or take, and that would be a variety of Yoshinos, as well as the Taiwans and Elantacs. So, as you know, we started offering those three varieties. We've always done Yoshinos, and we added Taiwans and Elantacs within the last couple of years.
One of our members, sir.
Yes.
Wayne.
Yes. Wayne provides us with the Taiwans.
You ever been over to his house?
Oh, yes, I
have. The jungle.
Yes, I have.
He is into that.
Yes.
And he's also a great addition to when we're down there selling them.
Absolutely. He keeps them because he really nourishes those trees. Like, it's almost like trees as far as the care and love that he puts into them. And just another example of the valuable resources and the people that volunteer with us, from Wayne and so many others, who really, truly care about this community. And in the case of the cherry blossom trees, we are excited and looking forward to seeing the many smiling faces that will come through during the 10 days of the festival.
Another purpose of selling these trees is to replenish our supply out in the neighborhoods, because we're known as the cherry blossom capital.
Yes.
And you can't keep that title if you don't have the trees out there.
Exactly. And another thing we're working on, and we don't have all the details in place, is just the overall revamp and revitalization of our cherry blossom trees from a tourism standpoint. It was also to not just for tourists, but for also those of us who are citizens of Macon Bibb. And so the trees that we sell typically are the trees that individuals are purchasing to plant in their yards. But we're also looking at the revitalization of the trees that are, you know, that our public has access to throughout the community, more so concentrating on the Carroll and Creighton Park downtown here and perimeters of downtown. So there'll be more, maybe next time I can come back and I can talk more in depth about that, because I'm excited about some of the things that we're already working on to revitalize our cherry blossom trees from a tourist standpoint.
A lot of people don't know this, but Keep Macon Bibb Beautiful is kind of the umbrella organization over Cherry Blossom Festival, because there would not have been a Cherry Blossom Festival created by Carolyn Creighton if she had not been the founder of Keep Macon Bibb Beautiful.
Exactly. That is a piece of history that a lot of people don't know. First of all, some people are aware that Carolyn Creighton is not only the founder of the Cherry Blossom Festival, but the founding executive director of Keep Macon Bibb Beautiful. And as you stated, the festival So when that event was held, who knew that it would be what it is today?
You say 40 plus. I think we're 49 years, or is this the 50th year?
Well, the Keep Macon Bibb Beautiful, March 1st to be exact, of this year will make 50 years. The awards ceremony that's held annually will be the 49th year of the Keep Macon Bibb Beautiful Award Ceremony, but the 50th year of Keep Macon Bibb Beautiful. So we're looking forward to, after we get the Cherry Blossom Festival, we're right into them preparing for our big 50th celebration, which will be the awards ceremony, which will be during the awards ceremony in May.
In May?
Yes.
Now, the awards ceremony honors what type folks?
Well, it honors us twofold. We always want to honor and recognize our various departments within Macon Bibb. Some I mentioned earlier, Parks and Rec, Parks and Beautification, our Sheriff's Department. So we recognize Macon Bibb employees who have made a huge contribution, and they're nominated by their directors. But the part where that's the citizens that are involved in, we recognize organizations as well as individuals for their various contributions to the things that they have done to help us with keeping Macon beautiful.
We have a nominating committee that takes care of that.
Yes.
And is everything complete yet?
It's almost complete. January 31st, the nomination committee will close nominations. So January 31st, and then from that point, we will go through and review the nominees per category to make the final decision. And so once that decision is made on the winners for each category, then those individuals will be contacted by myself and or our awards committee chair.
Now, after the awards, during the summer months, we have a lot of connection with the city of Macon and some of their cleanups.
Yes. Well, you know, we do cleanups all year round.
Oh, yes.
So, yeah.
In addition.
The Great American Cleanup that America Beautiful focuses on is from March 21st through June 20th. And so that's a time period where we have a lot of cleanups during that time. But just about on any given month, there's at least 2 to 3 cleanups going on somewhere, whether it's 2 to 3 people or 200 people. There's some type of cleanup going on. You may be referring to the countywide cleanups that usually the mayor initiates.
Yeah.
That's all we haven't heard from the mayor's office as far as if there will be or when there will be the countywide cleanups.
But there's going to be.
But I say this, we do countywide cleanups every day because we always have. Actually working with the Greek Historic Bible Neighborhood Association, even as we speak, they'll be doing a big cleanup the first Saturday of February in the area where Miller and Miller Middle School and Central High School. So, and then I have another group that I'm working with as far as some of the neighborhood watch associations as well. So, every day, we're planning for a countywide cleanup.
You know, you mentioned the schools. A lot of these youngsters get credit for their volunteerism. And I know Stratford Academy, for one, and you can take the right seat about everywhere.
Yes.
And a lot of the other schools and fraternities and sororities help out, too.
Yes, absolutely. Even just this past couple of weeks with the MLK holiday, we had some college students from Mercer University, various fraternities and sororities doing cleanup. But like you said, as far as even with the high school students, any student organization, whether high school or college, can do cleanup so students can earn volunteer hours through their service. We work a lot with the CTA, Career Technical Agricultural Education Program, with the school district, because there are a lot of organizations like FBLA or DECA, ecology clubs, numerous organizations, youth organizations, church groups that have done cleanups.
You're a member of a sorority too, a famous one.
Yes, I am.
And they participated in events.
Yes, I'm a member of Alpha Kappa Sorority Incorporated and actually chair our Enhancing Our Environment Committee. I guess they saw, you know, who wants to have a chair in this committee. and the executive director of Keep Macon Bibb Beautiful. So through that initiative, we do a lot of things from planting trees, community gardens, recycling events, as well as, of course, cleanup. Anything that involves enhancing our environment. But you don't have to be a member of my sorority to do those things. We have a lot of organizations, like I stated earlier, that have done numerous things from community cleanups to community gardens to tree planting, you name it.
We have just a few minutes remaining. Have you cleared your calendar yet for me, or do we have anything else we need to mention?
Oh, my goodness. You know, we're always doing various things. We have coming up also in February, Georgia Arbor Day.
That's right.
In Georgia, we celebrate Georgia Arbor Day on February 16th. And so working on a project, a tree planting project. We did the same project last year with Alexander 2 Elementary School with the third graders. So we're in the process of working on that. Arbor Day, but throughout the school year, I've had the opportunity to go into several of the schools, do presentations with students. We have some environmental books, also children's books, and do story time. So we're also working on that as well. So we got a whole list of things going on.
And that's just the first part of the year?
That's just the first part of the year.
Well, I appreciate you coming over, Asha, and tell us on the activities of Keep Macon Bibb Beautiful on its 49th going into its 50th year.
Thank you so much.
And thank you. Thank you, folks, for being with us today on our Middle Georgia Spotlight program. I'm Ron Wildman over here at WMUB.